Good morning, everyone. This is Tube 87, and to those who keep the Sabbath, I hope you're having a happy and a blessed Sabbath today. Now, what we're going to talk about today is beauty. Mind you, this is not to step on anyone's toes about how they look or how they feel about how they look. It is to give some perspective about what the world is focusing on and really what we should be focusing on, because the enemy will keep us and have us focused on outward things, worldly things, for the entirety of our lives to keep us from looking up at the Father. Beauty is one of those things where the Father created everything beautiful, but because of sin, it has distorted His creation. Remember, anything that we quote unquote perceive ugly or deformed is all the work of the enemy. The Father created perfection. Everything He has done is perfect. So we have to keep that in mind, and we have to work on our inner thinking, our inner thought process, and work on our inner beauty, our minds, and how we and change the way we perceive things that are outward. Always, we have to understand that these things are temporal. There are people out here who are truly deformed physically and literally, but yet they are some of the most beautiful people alive. And on the other side, there's some of the aesthetically most beautiful people we've ever seen out here based on our perceptions, but on the inside, they are rotten and ugly to the core. So we have to be very careful not to get caught up in vanity and the way things and ourselves, how something looks, and focus on the inward. With that being said, let's continue with our study. Beauty is skin deep. Now, first we're going to talk about a couple of words that are used in scripture to define how someone looks. One of the words is fair. Fair is a pleasing appearance, especially because of pure and fresh quality. So that is fair. Now, beauty is described by definition as a combination of qualities such as shape, color, or form that is that pleases the aesthetic senses, especially sight. And a second definition under that is a combination of qualities that pleases the intellect or moral senses. Now, I'm going to say right now, that's one that we should be more focused on, something that is more pleasing to the moral senses as opposed to the visual senses, because the visual senses can be blinding, they can be distracting, and that's what it is designed for when it comes to the enemy. He distracts us and blinds us with visual things, so we have to keep that in a perspective and not be deceived by it. Now, scripture is not lost on describing how someone looks. There have been plenty individuals throughout scripture who have been described as being fair or beautiful. Moses was described as fair. Esther was described as fair and beautiful. So needless to say, she was pleasing to the eye, and she was a beautiful person also. Number one on that list is Satan. Satan is described exceedingly in scripture in terms of how he looked and his appearance. Now, Ezekiel 28 gives us a lot of description of Satan. And verse 13 says, "Thou hast been in the Garden of Eden. Every precious stone was thy covering, the sardis, topaz, and the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, and the carbuncle, and gold. The workmanship of thy tabrets and of thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou was created." So it gives us a physical description of how beautifully he was covered in his adornment, and how beautiful his voice was. He could make musical sounds with his voice. That's what it's describing. He had the most beautiful voice that there was. He was given all these things. If we look down at verse 17, it says, "Thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. Thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness. I will cast thee to the ground. I will lay thee before kings, that they may behold thee." So Satan got caught up in his own beauty. He knew he was a beautiful creation in his look, in his voice, all these things. And he got caught up in all that. He felt like he could be a God. He could be above God. And he got caught up in his own beauty. This is about beauty and power. Now, if you are blessed with a pleasing aesthetic look about you, as most of us are, we have to be careful not to get caught up in trying to improve on something that's already acceptable. We should be working on our inner beauty. That's something people fail to do. Satan got caught up, like I said, in his own vanity. And Psalm 62:10 reads, it says, "Trust not in oppression and become not vain in robbery. If riches increase, set not your heart upon them." And then Luke 12:15 reads, "And he said unto them, take heed and beware of covetousness, for a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of things which he possesseth." If you're blessed with good looks, based on what we perceive as such, if you're blessed with things, scripture says, don't get caught up in coveting this, because if you start coveting, you're going to want more and more of it. You're going to be distracted by it. It's going to become a burden. It's going to become a downfall, because it's going to distract from where you need to be focusing. Now, 1 Timothy 6:7 reminds us, "For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out," and that includes our looks. So why get so distracted in spending the majority of our life focused on things we can't take with us? That inner is what we need to be focusing on. That's what's going to carry us one way or the other, that inner beauty that we have or don't have. 1 Timothy 2:9 makes a statement focused toward women and about their beauty. Because remember, most of this thing about beauty in the world focuses on women. So I'm going to read this scripture and touch on it for a second. It says, "In like manner also, that women adorn themselves in modest apparel, with shamefacedness and sobriety, not with broidered hair or gold or pearls or costly array, but which becometh women professing godliness with good works." So essentially, it's saying, don't get caught up in that appearance with your hair and putting all these things on, the Egyptian look. Remember, makeup and all these things comes from the Egyptian. They were really focused on beauty, and this is transcended through time, and we create what we perceive as beautiful instead of giving what we naturally have a chance to reveal itself as naturally beautiful. We start covering and painting and hair, doing extra things to our hair to give a perception of what we think the world wants. And 1 Peter 3:3-4 tells us, it reads, it says, "Whose adorning let it be not that outward adorning of plaiting of the hair and the wearing of gold or the putting on of apparel, but let it be the hidden man of the heart, in that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of God of great price." So the word tells us, hey, let's not focus on all this. Focus on this in here. Focus on your inner beauty. That's what the Father's looking at. Man is caught up on all this outward beauty, and like I said, it serves as a distraction, which is something we want to totally avoid. So look, people, the bottom line is that beauty is something that has been distorted by the enemy because of sin, and it serves as a distraction when we become consumed and focused on how we look or how someone else looks, and we get lost in this. We need to work on our inner beauty, the way we think, the way we view things, because all of creation is beautiful that the Father has created. All this worldly stuff is temporal. Remember the old saying, beauty is in the eye of the beholder, and the ultimate beholder is the Heavenly Father. All His creations and creatures are beautiful, so don't pass judgment on it because something is not beautiful to your eye. Be accepting of it, and don't get caught up. Don't even get caught up in yourself trying to improve on your beauty. What are you doing it for? Who are you doing it for? You should be doing it for the Father. Forget what the world wants. Focus on the Father, and He will lead you to all things. So, with that being said, remember, the Heavenly Father didn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is 2A7. I'm out.